says you can't get 100% whiter teeth? Writing's not that easy, but Grammarly can help.
Also, one of my absolute favorites.
You know what's never unpleasant, though? My segue to our sponsor. Ride it till it's over.
I'ma ride it till it's over. Media. We see it on our phones, the big screens, the walls of stores, billboards, everywhere.
And it's evolving every day. As the involvement of technology increases in our lives, there's always a hidden message in the media you are viewing.
This summer, PBS Guam, along with the Guam International Film Festival, Guam Community College, and Guam Behavioral Health and Wellness Center,
hosted a three-week boot camp educating teens on media literacy and mentoring a production team to create this documentary.
In week one, they learned about the world of media and deconstructed its elements using visual techniques such as canting and layout designs, and verbal techniques used in advertising, which includes ear cons and sonic branding.
They also learned how the media affects health decisions.
Have you thought about why you chose that brand of toothpaste you use? Chances are that you may have stumbled upon a Colgate ad without being fully aware of it.
Conventional fast food restaurant advertisements can determine what you'll be eating in the next hour. In weeks 2 and 3, bootcamp participants were challenged to film and produce their own documentary.
Each of them were placed into different production teams with mentors to assist them with their tasks.
Welcome to camp, where we create aspiring media producers.
What is media literacy?
So this is the fit check for today.
Media literacy is the ability to access, analyze, evaluate, and produce communication in a variety of formats.
I made it!
We began camp by diving into the basic understanding of media literacy. How media influences our decision making.
What'd you come up with? 2 hours? 3?
And how we can utilize techniques found in media.
Like, that's usually how the scene plays out.
The basic composition to draw your eye there, but it's actually meaningless. Because what the kid's doing is irrelevant to what the ad is trying to sell you.
So do you feel like they care about you? Absolutely not,
right? As a break from sitting for hours, we also did some daily exercises. Thanks, Mr. Don.
I learned a lot from this program. I've learned the different methods of persuasion. I've learned a lot about camera angles and all sorts of stuff that is kind of like behind the scenes of media rather than what's up front.
I learned the verbal and nonverbal ways that companies can persuade us to make health decisions, and I learned that these can be prevalent in more than just drug and alcohol advertisements. It's actually in the film and TV that we watch every day.
Canting, color, and the different types of scenarios put into advertisement to relate to other people.
So it's the way the camera perceives the color.
How to use equipment in certain departments when you're filming a film or a documentary.
We get to learn how to mic people up and learn how the audio works.
How to properly expose an image and how to frame someone up.
All sorts of stuff that I wouldn't have known or realized by just looking right at an example of media.
Keep it similar to this.
There were a lot of ways to go about this documentary, but we learned to tailor the questions to exactly what we wanted.
What do you notice about it?
It's all negative.
Yes, so it's negative, so it's serving the agenda for the counter ad to be persuasive, right? So as much as they want to persuade you with the original ad that it's a sexy front end, you're going to be served by all these guys, this is making it look like, you know, it's not attractive. But let's look at the text specifically.
We see media all over, like such as billboards, advertisement signs. We see it all over our mom and pop stores too.
How do I word this? It's all over the place and we can't escape it.
Having a basic sense of that should
make us more aware of that stuff and what people do to target us specifically.
The lessons we learned expand beyond the walls of the boot camp.
I chose to attend this program so I can build pillars of skills I can stand on.
Being a writer for this production, I think it was a very challenging position for me. It's a position that I think it's my weakest, but I think it's pretty fun because it helps me think about questions that get me to the answers that I needed.
I'm actually choosing to start a filmmaking career. So this is like a very like helpful program, learning about cameras and how basically film sets actually operate.
I like to make films or just skits with my cousins, and I think I could teach them the skills that I learned here at the media boot camp with camera angles, nonverbal techniques of persuasion, and just filming in general.
It's an advancement, and it's only helping us learn more about the world today, and it's also helping us get new information so that way we can adapt and evolve the right way.
Let's see it. Ooh. Is that the right health decision?
Now that textbook week is over, let's ask the experts of media. Nick Delgado, reporter for the Guam Daily Post, Isaiah John Uggan, reporter for KUAM, along with intern Kate Balser, and Crystal Paco San Agustin, Government of Guam Communications Director.
Well, the media, at least in my experience, has been tasked to hold people accountable, especially to follow the money and follow where our taxpaying dollars are going so that it's being put to good use. And this, in turn, of course, lets us decide who our elected officials should be and whether or not we are picking the right leaders to drive this community forward.
Personally, is that, sometimes I'll feel like I'm not doing enough. Right?
Media literacy is, as a journalist, making sure that you're giving out the most accurate information, making sure you know the limits and all the precautions you should take as to what you should report out there and project into the world.
She's sharing the best for the schedule.
I think media positively impacted our youth because it's encouraging them to chase their dreams. Like everyone in this room, I think it's very nice to see young faces interested in media. News and social media isn't what it is today, and so it's definitely improved, and I see a lot of people my brother's age, which is around 16, sharing posts from news, and I didn't see that in high school. So I definitely say social media is playing a role in getting people, the youth, the teenagers, and the early 20s, informed of what's going on in our community.
Hi, Francesca. My name is Jan. I will be your interviewer for today. So to start off the interview, go ahead and introduce yourself with your name.
My impression of the media is media defines each and every one of us, all of us who consume media, but most especially our youth, who are the most impressionable. It dictates what we see, what those messages are, how frequently we see them. Media has the power to tell us what we should look like, what we should say, how much we should value ourselves. I woke up this morning, the first thing I did was I looked at my smartphone. After I turned off my alarm clock, I read the headlines, and then I scrolled my social media. I scrolled my Instagram, I scrolled my Facebook to check what the big news was or if I got any messages while I was asleep. I drove to work, I listened to the radio, lots of media messages, lots of political signs on the way to work. I also saw those digital billboards. I then got to the office, lots of ads popping up when you're reading the news, when you're scrolling through Facebook, get a text, get a WhatsApp, some ad was sent to me, lots of family chats over WhatsApp, lots of group chats we're all a part of, and we're always sharing media. We're always consuming media. And so media now is so instantaneous. You don't have to wait till 6 p.m. to get your news. You don't have to wait till tomorrow's paper. You can get it now. But there are consequences to that because sometimes it's misinformation, it's disinformation we're all exposed to all the time. Anyone and everyone can post on the internet. But just because it's on the internet doesn't make it true. Just because my dad shared a post on WhatsApp doesn't make it true. Was it Photoshopped? Was the video edited? Was it altered in any way? And so it's important for us to know what's fact from fiction, be able to decipher what's a biased news story, what's a fake news outlet, to seek out the truth, to seek out balanced news articles, balanced news outlets. You know, when be able to see the red flags that it's not a true source. You know, is it balanced? Did they get both sides of the story? Did they try to tell both sides of the story? You know, what are they saying? Are they, is it a defamation? Is what are they trying to say? Is there any motive behind the messaging they're putting out? And so media literacy is so important for you and your families, for you to make the best decisions, the most informed decisions for you and your families. Media can negatively impact how we view ourselves, and I think for our youth that can be devastating, especially when we grow up thinking we have to look a certain way, be a certain way, make this much money, have this many friends. And also I think media, especially social media, has changed how we actually communicate with one another, how we engage with one another. You go out to dinner, what are people doing? They're taking pictures of their food and they're probably all on their phones. And so it's changed how we communicate, especially face to face. But in the same, in contrast, media brought us together over the COVID pandemic when we weren't allowed to be together. It kept us connected. It kept many of us sane. It kept us communicating. It kept us in touch. You know, sanity, connection is so important to your mental health and well-being. And so media can also be a powerful outlet for that. And a perfect example of that is the Black Lives Matter movement. Millions across the nation, you came together over social media to post little black boxes to say something loud and clear. And here on Guam, we're seeing groups like Femalawan Rights, you know, to educate. Their goal is to educate people using social media platforms, leveraging social media to educate them on the contrast, the differences between the pro-choice movement and the pro-life movement. What's fact from fiction? And their advocacy, of course, is the woman's right to privacy, is the woman's right to my body, my choice. And so media can change the world. But again, it's the matter of, you know, the call to action. What are you calling us to do? What do you want us to do? And I think the youth are the most impressionable, and they're the ones really using social media to change the world.
We have a slot open from 10:20 to 10:35. If you don't want to move anything around, because we already scheduled all the mentors or some mentors.
For those interested in media, here's some advice our experts and mentors had to offer.
Listen to radio stations, listen to news outlets, watch news, because I believe it helped me in my voice, finding my voice, developing how I sound, how I look, how I present myself, what to say on social media and what not to say. But really study through watching and listening, just so you kind of get an idea of what to sound like, and just to build your own voice.
Be persistent, make sure you do your research, and just make sure that you approach every story with compassion and a real intent to make change, and always remain unbiased and separated, even if in a community like this in Guam, you have a close connection.
My advice for teens pursuing media is you can do it. Start today. It's easy. You own a smartphone, you can become a reporter. You're already reporting, and I tell this at all the career days, especially with little kids or young adults. You know, what are you doing on your Instagram? You're taking photos of your food. You're taking photos of your friend. I'm at the beach. I'm at the park. I'm doing this. You're already reporters. You're already consumers of media. You're already media, you already put out so much media. And so I think my best advice for any young person wanting to pursue media is to start today.
Lastly, our mentors who guided us throughout the 3 weeks in making this documentary. Sean Camacho, camera and editor mentor. Rizal Almond, writing mentor. Nick Santos, director mentor. Don Munya, production mentor. And Kel Munya, audio mentor.
Okay, so this is gonna sound kind of silly because I'm an adult, but I really love, and I have always really loved, media films and TV shows that were geared towards teenagers. That hasn't changed very much. And the reason why is that I think that the age range for teenagers and young adults is such an important time for people who are growing up. The things that we see, the things that they're reading, the things that they're learning, these are, to me, the most formative years. And this is the time where everything that they learned will impact their adulthood. They carry these things into their adulthood. A lot of people, when they get older, they remember like the things that they saw and listen to. Some people say that even that, like, the music that you listen to when you're a teenager, that's the music that you prefer, continue to prefer. And I think that that pretty much goes for anything.
When media tries to portray the life of a teen, it kind of goes two ways. There's one where it's very commercial, and then there's the other way where it's more realistic and very thoughtful. So when you have media literacy, it's kind of like a superpower hiding in plain sight. That is to say, you get to understand the media and kind of unveil the hidden layer of its messages. And so it's like the nutrition facts for media, right? The more you know what's in the media message, what the ingredients are, the better shape you'll be in. So I think it depends on your perspective. If you're a conscious media consumer, you might understand that the teenager themselves is just so very thoughtful, and there's so many dimensions to the teenager. But if you're not such a conscious consumer, if you are lacking that superpower of media literacy, then you might just take it for what it's worth and agree with everything how it's portrayed. So I guess it depends on your perspective.
The best way to empower teens and young adults is to allow them to control the message, or allow them to create the content themselves, which at this point, in the year 2022, it's super easy. At this point, it's like they have the ability to do that at the palm of their hands. You know, back when I was growing up, you had to have a camera, you had to have a computer, you had to have internet, which not everybody did, but now pretty much anybody can do it. And so what this program aims to do is to help aid them into creating that kind of content, giving them a voice to send messages to other people, while also being able to give them the tools to also be able to discern media, right? Like I said, anybody can create content. And so now we are in a place where we are overloaded with information. We are overloaded with media. And it's getting harder to be able to discern what media we are consuming is actually helping us, what media is actually helping our community. And so the reason why I wanted to become part of that program is because I wanted to be part of that process. I wanted to be able to say that I was helping young adults to help discern the media, and also to help them create content that empowers them.
Take the things that you do have and start creating.
Years and years back, the Guam International Film Festival was fortunate enough to partner up with the Department of Youth Affairs and Guam Behavioral Health and Wellness for a public service documentary called Banner Bandits. And in Banner Bandits, we looked at alcohol and tobacco advertisements in the villages of Guam and how that may affect, you know, the perspective of the youth. And that kind of was the beginning of me feeling that more people need to be aware of, like, the subliminal messaging that media conveys. and what those types of impressions in a youth's mind, how that would shape a youth's mind. Media literacy isn't something traditionally taught in public school systems. I feel that there needs to be more presence in media literacy, just like there should be more presence of financial literacy. You know, it's the things that we engage in daily that we have to be most aware of and understand, you know, how to apply it in our everyday lives. So it was a mixture of that partnership back in, I think, 2013, and then just recently being a father, you know, just knowing that we're technology and communications is evolving and becoming so much more prevalent in our communities. I just wanted to make sure that I was doing the best in my profession to be responsible and make an impact, a positive impact in my community. For PBS Guam, because it's such a, you know, community invested organization, there was hardly much pushback or much difficulties. I had a lot of great partnerships, a lot of great stakeholders, and they were all, you know, very supportive, because I think too they share the understanding, you know, of the importance of media literacy, especially today. So no real difficulties, but the way that I was able to put it together was just with the buy-in of really important and influential partnerships like Guam Behavioral Health and Wellness, peace.org, the Guam Community College, the Guam International Film Festival, and of course PBS Guam.
I do in my everyday life is I am a mental health advocate. I do work with Guam Behavioral Health and Wellness on some stuff. I did work on a short film with them that was sort of around teen mental health, like young adult mental health. And there are some other things that I've done with them. I also do like, I also do a podcast called Everything's Cherry, where we just kind of talk about mental health and mental illnesses, and just kind of try to open up that conversation. Guam Behavioral Health in general is like a really great resource for that. If you guys ever want to work on like mental health stuff or like substance abuse stuff, like they're super open about like creating projects and working together in partnership for that stuff.
To understand why this bootcamp was created, our mentors told us what led them to get involved and what they hope students will gain from the program.
I hope that the students gain the ability to just to be a more conscious consumer of media, because then in turn they become a more conscious media maker. And the media message doesn't have to necessarily be and stop at film. It's everything. It makes you a better communicator. It makes you a better marketer. It makes you a better listener. There are so many ways that understanding media literacy can help the actual individual to not only create better content, but be a more fit and more conscious consumer of content.
I hope that students will gain the experience from this program needed to go out and find their careers in media, whether it be in production, or filmmaking, or design, or any other aspect of media. I hope that they gain the tools needed to go out and produce breathtaking as well as society-changing films.
I hope students will gain a good understanding of how to use media both to convey a message as well as how does media affect them, and how do the people who create media create messages that are effective in telling them what to do, or are on the other hand effective in communicating a certain culture.
I think just by growing up in the earlier stages of independent filmmaking on Guam, I think it's been really validating to see other filmmakers grow alongside with me. And by that, I mean, it's nice to see, feel seen, right? Growing up on Guam is such a unique experience. And so one of the positive impacts that that media has had on me in relation to that is just being able to feel seen and being able to feel heard and feeling empowered just by seeing, you know, creators like myself create content that I can relate to, which is really hard, you know, when I'm watching Netflix and stuff. But I cry every time whenever I see somebody, you know, whenever there's something that I really feel seen, really feel heard, and it's somebody that grew up here or somebody like in this region, it makes me feel good about myself and about my community.
Energy up, and 3, 2, 1, let's go, let's go, let's go, let's go. Get it, get it, get it, get it. Yay! Hold it, hold it, hold it. Wave back there, wave, wave. All right. Okay, that's it.
And that's a wrap. Thank you to the various organizations who supported this bootcamp and to our mentors for teaching us and helping us improve our media skills. And to you, viewers, we hope this inspires you to learn more about media literacy.
And remember, there's always a hidden message in the media you are viewing. So, what's ours?